Sitting alone, the journey of life. Sizzling monsoon danced at me. Cool was the rain, fresh from above. I saw her, sitting by the window side, enjoying the grazing cows, the enchanting clouds, the drumbeats of thunder. She sang a silent song.
ठीक हो जाएंगे हम तो जब तक जिएंगे यहीं रहेंगे
सर्वशक्तिमान प्रभु सर्वशक्तिमान सर्वशक्तिमते परमात्मा श्री रामाय नमः
दवाई भी अच्छी है दवाई जो है अच्छी है
हरे राम 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 हरे हरे हरे
हमने दिल्ली में दिखाया था एफएनएसी कराया बायोप्सी कराया तो डॉक्टर ने बोला कि मतलब आपकी सर्जरी होगी कीमोथेरेपी होगी रेडियम होगी पहले फिर सर्जरी भी हो सकती है हम कुछ कह नहीं सकते तो फिर मेरे को इरादा कि मैंने सर्जरी नहीं करानी फिर मुझे यहाँ पे पता चला हिमाचल में डॉक्टर का भी यहाँ पर इलाज है तिप्टी डॉक्टरों का
The teaching of the Tibetan medicine is like this, you know, it's like, it's not a question of just, you know, treating the disease. It's all about understanding the way of living. It's all about understanding the whole universe. Why the universe is formed and what power, what energy, the connectivity, the cause and effect, which has brought this universe into existence. Truth of the suffering, the cause of the suffering, and the way to end the suffering, and finally, liberation from the suffering. Oh, these are the teachings.
Dharamsala, nested at the foot of the Himalayas in the far northern corner of India, is where our story begins. In 1959, His Holiness the Dalai Lama fled his home in Tibet and, after a long and dangerous journey, found refuge here and has resided here ever since. Now a new generation of Tibetan doctors, or Menpas, climb these mountains in search of healing plants.
My father tried. He attempted to become a physician, but I think he couldn't do that. And he, you know, wanted me to become an Amchi to carry on that lineage. So I joined Tibetan medicine, non-Tibetan medicine.
little has changed in this ancient practice in the centuries since it's begun. Plants and herbs that grow in high altitudes are said to be nourished by the sun and the moon in the same way that lunar and solar energies breathe life into our own bodies. As yin and yang in Chinese, or sibs and dag in Tibetan. Tibetan healers use these plants to treat illnesses such as diabetes, Alzheimer's, and cancer, and many other chronic diseases that disturb the harmony of the body.
When I was small, I wanted to become a doctor, but I was not so interested in Western medicine, so it was like, oh, I don't want to spend 7 years of my life to give people the chemical medicine, yeah? I was asking many people, where can I learn Tibetan medicine? And then they thought, the Tibetans in Moscow, yeah? They thought that the best way to learn Tibetan medicine is to go to Mensikan in Dharamsala. It's the best place. Before, Tibetan medicine was not popular in Russia or in the West, but nowadays there are so many Tibetan doctors who come to Russia. So in Moscow there are so many people who take Tibetan medicine and they are very happy. Yeah?
It's Inga's first trek into the mountains in search of medical plants, the first of many trips in the coming years as she continues her study of plants and healing.
They came yesterday in the evening. They are staying today, tonight, and tomorrow afternoon they will be back. During that time, you know, we have to collect it because we use it for our own purpose next day. So it's quite hard work, you know.
As the grey clouds gather above, the crew takes shelter until the rain passes. It's the monsoon, and they could be waiting for hours. Finally, the rain stops and they continue their journey beyond the snow line. It will be another long day of travel before they return home. Meanwhile, 3,000 miles to the south, the city of Bangalore is just awakening, already warmed by a midsummer breeze. Coming from a long line of traditional Menpas, Dr. Dorje studied at the Menzi Kang and is now the highly respected director of the Bangalore Clinic.
Tibetan medicine is one of the most ancient cultural heritage of Tibetan people. Bone tradition, Bone school of thought believes that the Tibetan medicine, the origin of the Tibetan medicine is dated back, way back to, you know, the much before even the Buddha's kind of period also. The Buddhist school of thought believes that Tibetan medicine came 6th centuries and 7th centuries, you know, when the Buddhism finally came from India to Tibet. Compared to our predecessors, the ancient, you know, physicians, ancient masters, and whereas we, in compared to them, we are nothing. We are very, very, you know, a kind of miniature. It's like comparing, you know, a firefly with the sun. Our ancient masters are like a sun. their achievement, their kind of knowledge is something very, very vast and completely kind of fulfilled.
Before starting their day in the clinic, the practitioners pray to Menla, the medicine Buddha, in order to focus all their healing energies on treating their patients.
We have been praying every day in the morning before we start our practices, and then doctors has to all get the real initiations of the medicinal Buddha. All these forms part of the spiritual awakening of the doctor's kind of the mind, the doctor's motivation. We used to pray about this four immeasurables, infinities, like, you know, immense kind of compassion, you know, for the patients who are really suffering, you know, compassion, deep-seated kind of compassion.
Every other week, Dr. Dorje travels to the cities of South India, treating patients who depend on his visits for their care.
Serving others, you know, that kind of service is something which is very supreme, and we call it jimba, charity of giving life to somebody who really need it. And with the help of your profession, you're able to help him to achieve that, bring some measure of hope and smile in their face, gives us a great kind of, you know, inner strength also, satisfaction.
We are now headed to Menzi Kang to witness the production of the traditional medicines and see how the Tibetan healing system is being taught to a new generation of student doctors who aspire to follow in the footsteps of the renowned Tibetan healers of the past. The plants collected from the mountains are brought down for processing. They are documented, cleaned, dried, detoxified, and then pulverized, each step following a strict set of regulations. Dr. Tenzin Taya, senior physician and teacher at Menzi Kang, is also a practicing monk. While Tibetan medicine is deeply rooted in the Buddhist teachings, one does not need to be a Buddhist to benefit from it.
In past, the Tibetan doctors, most of them are monks, because in the village, they don't have much school for study Tibetan medicine. And also the big monasteries, each of them have medicine classes. So they teach to the monks. Then whenever the monk, they go back to their village, then they stay there and to do practice medicine.
Dr. Taya, who fled Tibet in the 1970s, is fulfilling his lifelong dream of becoming a monk in Dharamsala. And at the same time, he is a leading Menjor Menpa, a doctor of medicine making, responsible for overseeing this large-scale medicine production. Menzi Kang carries out regular evaluations of its medicines, striving to improve their efficiency in treating a variety of illnesses. At the same time, the core of Tibetan medicine, deeply rooted in the practices of compassion, has never changed. The blessing of each new batch of medicine is an essential part of the process.
In Buddhist practice, whatever, do something good for others, that is the best practice. So the medicine is very, very special because we produce medicine. When we are produce medicine, we never say, okay, I produce this medicine, I will kill this person, or this will harm that person, or something like that. We always think, okay, this will give some people relief, give some people who have a suffering, so to have a disease. If this I met well, meet good, then they will get more benefit or this. We always have a really good emotion there. That's very important.
The evolution of Tibetan medicine in the West is continually finding a balance between these traditional practices and the Western scientific guidelines that dictate how medicines are produced and documented. The once handmade pills and powders are now produced by efficient machines and can be distributed across the world.
Medicine we call it Renaissance pill, about 70 different ingredients. So it's very good for nervous system, blood pressure, especially also very good for cancer, brain cancer, all these things. It's a very good medicine. And also paralysis, it's a very good medicine. The yellow, you see this very good the yellow pills. The yellow, we call it tangzhou. Tangzhou is about 150 different ingredients. So this is very good for all kinds of poison, and also purified blood. And also very, very good for famous and very acute cancer pain. Mm. Acute cancer, yes. It's very, very good.
I'm a dental surgeon, practicing private practice for the past 28 years. So I write a lot of allopathy medicines. There is always product information along with the medicine. That's what we are used to. It may have some trade name, but what is the chemical that's inside, and what is the normal effect, what is the side effect, and drug interaction, you cannot give this medicine with that. All that information is readily available in our system. Tibetan medicine, nothing is there. All the medicines look the same. They are either small brown ones or big brown ones, black ones. They all look the same. So I even asked him once, what does this contain? At least tell me some names. He said, this one pill contains 35 herbs. Of that, he told some name. It was totally a bouncer. I don't remember anything. And he said, this medicine is the active ingredient. The other things will supplement its action.
Or first powder it, powder put in your mouth and drink boiled warm water. Water should be boiled and warm. Okay, understood.
So I was always scared ki what I'm swallowing and what is happening to that. Even though I tell my prayer and take, but inside that 5% doubt was there ki what's happening. That is why every year I make it a point to do my blood test. When I do the blood test, I check for my liver function as well as my kidney function. So till now, all my liver function tests, all my renal function tests are coming normal. I have no issues.
What is the relationship between science and Buddhism? Is there a way that these seemingly different worldviews can benefit each other in the future? The Dalai Lama has encouraged an ongoing dialogue between scientists and Buddhist thinkers, even going so far as to say that if scientists ever disprove a Buddhist belief, it is Buddhists who must learn to adapt.
Buddhism and science, it's a... In other words, it should be one. Buddha itself says, okay, I found this, just please do analyze it. Don't think this is, I said, just blindly you believe it. We have a saying that gold, when we check the gold, we have to check, cut it, we have to buy it. Then like that, there's many ways to check is it real gold or not. The same way you have to check, analyze the philosophy of Buddhism. So I think it's similar, very similar.
Tibetan medicine's popularity is growing. In India alone, there are 54 branch clinics led by practitioners like Dr. Dorji. Tibetan doctors now travel to Europe and America to treat their growing number of patients. As the Tibetans themselves have spread out across the world, so has this ancient healing system that is now finding its way into every corner of the globe.
See the sound?
Yeah.
You could feel the difference?
Yes.
You know, in the ethics of the Tibetan physician, we call it a whole chapter on the qualities and the integrity of being a physician, in which it was clearly mentioned that doctor has to be expert in every field. The Tibetan medicine being a more of a holistic kind of system, you know, you got to know that you just can't say that, well, I can treat your heart, but I will not treat your kidney. So everything is interrelated, you know. So therefore, Tibetan doctors have to be specialized in every field.
Little yellowish, little oily, you know, little oily also. I mean, you could see these small particles floating, you know?
Yes, sir.
These small particle floatings are because of the indigestion.
There are three main diagnostic approaches in Tibetan medicine: observing, feeling, and interrogation. Pulse and urine analysis are the most important of these diagnostic methods.
This bubble, which is, you know, normally it disappears, you know.
Okay.
But in his case, it's not disappearing; it is staying.
Okay.
You know, this could show a bit of a, you know, congestions.
The urine's color, bubble formation, sedimentation, and even smell can be indications of illness. Tibetans believe that it's all connected with the food we eat. Indigestion, they believe, is one of the main causes of disease. Next is the interrogation. Are you happy? Stressed? Going through difficult times?
They treat the patient as a whole. They don't, you know, there is the growth, I need to remove that. They'll not see only that. Overall, he says, generally you're doing well, that is more important. Once your feeling of that well-being is there, the growth will automatically go. I feel through our own mind and our internal energies, he's trying to focus that and trying to make it go. It's like a bad child who cries, and then you pay attention, it cries more. You turn this way and that fellow keeps quiet. I feel he's treating the tumors like that.
Patients must be willing to change their habitual ways of living in order to be fully healed. It's easy to fall into despair and lose hope when faced with a diagnosis of cancer. Dr. Dorje, like the other Tibetan doctors, was not trained specifically in cancer treatment, but news traveled fast of his success and patients began to arrive at the clinic in search of treatment.
We were spending billions of dollars. Then we find that, oh yeah, this cancer cells act this way, this cancer cells act that way, you know? So it's a new findings. But for us, for Tibetan doctors, it's not something which is new. You know, it's already mentioned in the Tibetan medical text, they say Juche. It was clearly mentioned, that was almost like 800 years before. And clear description of the cancer itself. If not treated early, it becomes almost impossible to treat at the advanced stages. Tendency of the disease to slowly suck up, to take up the nutrients of the body systems for its own growth, you know, and leaving the, you know, body totally defenseless. It was also clearly mentioned in the medical text.
It's early in the morning and the students are hard at work, memorizing an ancient medical text, the Juche. It is said to have first been taught by the Buddha himself. And since that time, it has been passed down through a continuous lineage of physicians. The Juche is a comprehensive text that documents the teachings on the three humors that keep our bodies in balance: Lung, Tripa, and Beken.
lung, it's a kind of energy in our body. It seems like outside wind. It's whenever outside the wind is moving, the trees are moving. The same way the energy, that energy in our body is moving. Then the qipa. Qipa means all kinds of heat. And also in our body, there's a liquid, like water and earth, the solid. All this we call it peking. So the three hum are always working in our body. But whenever these balance, they have always balance in the balanced state. When they are balanced, they work together like a friend, like brothers. They work very, very good in our body. But whenever there's imbalance, some are very too much, some are less, then they have a contradiction, like a fight each other. Because of this, we cause the disease. And also the same about cancer. Three humor can be due. Like some cancers are caused more by wind, then or some are more caused by qipa, and also some, of course, caused by peking. Those cancer which is caused by wind, it means very unstable. Sometimes swollen bigger, sometimes shrinking, and also sometimes too much pain, and sometimes not too much pain like that way. And also the same qipa, because of qipa is a kind of heat. So whenever cancer caused by qipa heat, then maybe little danger. You have to be careful because this very, very quickly arrives. In fact, then of course it goes to blood and this will transform to the whole body. All part of our body, there's three humors working, purifying each steps. Impure blood, impure liquid, impure solid, wherever this accumulate in our body part, then it become a cancer. So this is a very, very important concept of Tibetan medicine.
Flashes of life in mind's silver screen, dancing flames to the tune of winds. A silent song, a silent prayer. The sky so vast, the path so long. A life to live with the smile you gave.
Cancer is a disease which puts you down to the floor. It just pushes you. It doesn't warn you. It's an equalizer. It's a great equalizer. It can happen to anyone, be it rich or poor or
can be a Hindu, Muslim, across caste, creed, religion. It's an equalizer. It just humbles you and pushes you down physically, mentally, psychologically, even financially.
Cancer, it is not something which is very bad, not something which is totally unwanted, but something which probably the Almighty has given you a kind of, you know, the opportunity to transform yourself, you know, by undergoing this suffering, struggles.
Normally, if you have some illness, if you take medicine, you feel better. But in case of cancer, you take chemo or radiation, you become worse. So that's irony. Because normally you take medicine, it should cure you. Say for example, my mom was weighing around 75 kg in 2009. It went down to around 50, 40, something like that. So that was one of the major issues, which was a major side effect of the treatment. And that's when we heard about Tibetan medicine. Her appetite became better. She was able to eat better. Of course, she has to selectively eat, but she started getting control of her body again.
There are many other cancer patients like Eshwar's mother who come to the clinic from different walks of life.
I'm 56 years old now. I was diagnosed with cancer 3.5 years ago, 2009 June. And I went to the Tibetan for the Tibetan treatment simultaneously with allopathic medicine. I had 8 chemos. And the usual side effects happened. You lose all your hair, your eyebrows, my nails fell off. And my eyes would water, you know, some sticky fluid would come from my eyes the whole time. Zero taste. So all that was there, but I really didn't suffer in terms of, I went about my life pretty normally because I was on Tibetan medicine. So my energy levels really didn't fall to that extent. I was lucky because most patients go there when they're terminal. So I was lucky I started it. I was a third stage cancer patient, breast cancer patient, and I always was into alternative medicine because I'd had a few bad experiences with allopathic. But I mean, when you have cancer, something so big, you know, the automatic, and I guess for an emergency, it's good. It has its effect, allopathic with surgery. It's more advanced when it comes to surgery, etc. So I guess it's got its role to play in the whole field of medicine. So I guess because of family pressure, there was no avoiding allopathic medicine when I got cancer.
Yeah, this pain was reduced, mm-hmm. But disease has not
been. After the radiation, this pain.
It is quite common for patients to switch from Western to Tibetan medicine after surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation, like Dr. Revathi did.
So this shows where all they have removed the tumor, plus a part of the small intestine also. And they did a presentation of mine, that's how I got this photograph. That way they removed around 7.5 kg. 7.5 kg they removed. I came to know about him from my father-in-law. He was reading some magazine and he said, this looks like very safe and all Ayurvedic herbal thing, why don't you try that? We had no choice. And I didn't want my lifestyle to be again and again disturbed like this. One surgery means we are out of action.
That is one thing. It's still there, slight bit of a, you know, the stress and strain in the heart.
I wanted to try this. Last 7-8 years, I've been on Tibetan medicines. And I'm also monitoring my growth regularly. And now, the last 7-8 years, the growth is there, but it's very, 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 very slow. Another big thing is my quality of life, my day-to-day activities, nothing is disturbed. Oh, because the tumor being removed and getting 100% success on that, leaving the patient totally incapacitated, no? You're handicapped kind of thing, is not quality life. No? There may be a growth here, and they say, this fellow will spread here, you cut this arm, I've won over the tumor. But what happened to the patient? He's left with no arm. So, I mean, we have to make a choice.
हम यहाँ आ गए एकदम से, फिर हमने यहाँ पे ट्रीटमेंट शुरू कर ली। हाँ उन्होंने कहा क्यों क्यों विश्वास करते हैं दवाइयों पे?
और फिर भी ना आपने सर्जरी किया नहीं ना?
नहीं मतलब अब ट्रीटमेंट मेरे को 2 मंथ होने वाले हैं। पहले मेरे को पेन होता था, अब पेन कम है। पहले बहुत ज़्यादा होता था, जख्म था ऊपर, वो भी कम है। अब मैं कॉन्फिडेंस से दवाई मेडिसिन खा रही हूँ, अपनी कॉन्फिडेंस से।
When Tibetan doctors feel the patient's pulse, it is not only the heartbeat they're looking for. They attribute different characteristics of pulse to different organs of the body. Using 3 fingers from each hand, they feel the vibrations of each organ.
Her breast cancer is a little big. In her pulse, there's a little infection. The pulse from the 2 finger is more strong. It means upper body have a more little infection. When you touch it, you feel it like strong, but when you pressure more, it's not pumping there. It means empty. So she have a kind of also coldness in the kidneys, lower body, wound and cold.
अब मैं देखता हूँ, मुझे इधर सो जाते हैं, थोड़ा कम पेन है। पहले जी पहले मैं तो सो नहीं सकती थी। या सीधा सोती हूँ ऐसा कभी होती है, कभी रुक जाती है।
दुख हुआ था?
हाँ खुश हूँ।
नहीं नहीं, जब आपको कैंसर पता चला है ना, तो आपके परिवार वाला कैसा वो कर रहे हैं
आपसे? वो तो बहुत परेशान हो गए।
परेशान हो?
हाँ, रोना शुरू कर दिया, मम्मी ये क्या हो गया, मम्मी ये क्या हो गया, आपको आपने क्यों नहीं ऐसा ध्यान दिया।
Those people who have a proper cancer in the breast, they have always have an emotion. Mainly for they have a more connect with heart. Whenever you have a very much emotion, then you feel pain here. Of course, this more strong, but both side also. Then what it mean? Because all the energy, the block is accumulate here. उस टाइम में अच्छा सोचना है, अब दूसरा देखना है, दूसरा लोग को जो आपसे बहुत बहुत खराब का चीज़ है। कोई आदमी तो हमेशा हर साल में मतलब पाँव दोनों धोने, कोई आदमी तो हमेशा जो हॉस्पिटल सोते ये नहीं होता है, दिमाग नहीं होता है, वो चीज़ आपके लिए बहुत वो के लिए आपके बहुत अच्छा है। आपका इन्हें खास आता है, इन्हें जास आता है, इन्हें पर्स आता है, इन्हें
वी हैव अ सेइंग, इफ द वर्ल्ड इज फुल ऑफ थॉट, यू कैन नॉट cover the world, but you have to only cover your feet. That's enough. That's what it means, is you should not go out just look for happiness. You have to go inside, then just change your mind, then you will get the happiness. Okay?
वो अपनी बीमारी के बारे में मेरे को थोड़ा मन हल्का हो जाता, मन हल्का हो जाता, दिल मेरा जो ना वीक है, डॉक्टर साहब भी कहते हैं आपका दिल बहुत वीक है, आप कंट्रोल करो, आप थोड़ा विल पावर स्ट्रॉन्ग बनाओ, आप ठीक हो जाओगे, अभी कॉन्फिडेंस।
Patients do have a responsibility. If they try to be a little more ignorant, if they depend heavily on the doctors alone, the whole attitude is narrow-minded. People should understand that treatment approach, the health approach, is much more important than the treatment itself. Then, mind, mentally trying to be more positive, more truthful, always think on the better side of the life.
My dad, days passed by and all, but then he never lost hope, okay? That was one of the biggest asset which he was already holding. He always, you know, wished for something good. Even though having such kind of a disease, he never let himself down. He kept on fighting back, you know, and instead he used to tell other people, you know, whatever you do, it must be the actions of your past which are actually getting answered now. Okay, so it's like you have to accept in life, like it's written, whatever is written, that has to be, you know, you have to go through those periods and all. He never had any fear of death. Okay, he always told me, like, if God comes to me tomorrow and he picks me up, he takes me away and all, I'm ready to go.
I realized the power of the mind fully when I got cancer. And when I really like came in touch with Tibetan medicine closely, so and the doctors told me to meditate. That's when I really realized the power of the mind, how important it is.
Good. So you are in the Buddhahood now.
I was a mastectomy case, and the doctor, when I first, the first doctor I met, the first oncologist I met, told me I must have a mastectomy right within a week. I should have it right away, but I didn't. I resisted because I felt he was creating fear in me. I felt a doctor needs to take away my fear.
And we were looking at photographs yesterday,
yeah,
from her chemo days.
Yeah. No, much kind of younger, much fresh looking.
Absolutely.
Much more energetic. Even, you know, could say it's...
I'm more energetic, you know, than, you know, before I had cancer.
Mm.
The drama in cancer really comes from the treatment, from the allopathic treatment. You know, you see patients bald, no nails. Obviously, they look very, very tragic and stuff. But I'm saying if you just saw cancer patients who hadn't done any chemo, it's not that tragic. You getting what I'm saying? So the whole drama in cancer comes from chemo. And makes for a very good story also.
Since most cancer patients have first undergone Western treatments, Tibetan doctors have found it necessary to develop a thorough understanding of Western medicine in order to provide their patients with better treatment.
Did you have the recent blood test done?
Yeah, we did. I didn't get the report. Right?
How much it was, remember? Hemoglobin, WBC?
Hemoglobin was 11.6.
11.6, yes. Not bad, huh? Not bad.
Usually, you know, after every chemo radiations or something which he goes through, the normal blood cells and all count goes down to around 2000, I guess, around 2000 to 3000, the WBC count, right?
Yeah.
The WBC counts goes down to 2000 to 3000 and all, which is like, you know, it makes him much more weaker.
Should be minimum from 5000 to 11000, the count should be there.
Yeah.
But he used to always have 2500 or 3000.
So, yeah. Which means the immunity is going down, the body immunity is going down.
Eltroxin you're taking?
Thyroxin.
It's the same. MG. Same. 50 mg. You make it 25 mg, don't increase it. 25 mg.
So, for the first time when he went through the chemotherapy and when he was taking along with this Timensikang medicines and all, we got a surprising result. You know, usually what I said was like the WBC goes down to 2000. And when he started taking these medicines after the chemotherapy, the reading goes only down to 5000 to 6000, you know. So we actually got a little bit faith in the medicines that there's something which is, you know, actually provoking the WBC not to lose hope.
After my surgery, I took something called tamoxifen, which a cancer patient has to take, every breast cancer patient takes for about 5 years. It's a must, every cancer patient takes. I took it for 8 months, and then they told me one of the side effects of that medicine is uterine cancer. It's there in the pack insert, it's there online, you can find it. It sounds strange, but it's true. And my doctor said it happens 1 in a million cases. That's what they say, but my uterine walls swelled up. So in the ultrasound, it showed up like that. And they told me it's probably induced by tamoxifen. But my doctor told me you do a biopsy to rule out cancer, to rule out uterine cancer, by which time I'd had enough. So I said, no, I'm not taking any more medicine. I'm just staying with Tibetan medicine. And my doctor was alarmed, you know, he was completely, he said, how can you do this? How can you, I mean, you have to take it as a breast cancer patient.
We married after my cancer. We were friends while I had cancer. We got married short time ago. Taking the chemo. Look at the book I'm reading, You Can Heal Your Life.
ये वाला दवा आप कंटिन्यू लेना है ठीक है ये अलग से रखा है
मुझे पता है
ये आपका हाथ नहीं रखेगा
अच्छा दवाई तो 7 दिन की दी है
नहीं फिर वो वाले गोली है ना उसको भी कंप्लीट कर लेना ठीक है आप बीच में ज़्यादा फिक्र नहीं करना सोचना नहीं है कि हम ये बीमार है करके बिल में ये सोचना ये हम खाना पीना हमारा काम है अभी जो कुछ करेगा वही लोग करेगा हम अपने विश्वास पे लेना है ठीक है फिर आप ज़्यादा सोच के ना फिर तबियत बिगड़ जाएगा ना देखो आपका पति इतना अच्छा है देखो
Unfortunately, what happened was the tumor spread. She used to have colon cancer. That means it was spreading in that area alone, the stomach area alone. But then it spread to her hip region, a pelvic region, and it spread to the other region, which became a bit uncontrollable.
The most important thing is to understand the nature of the cancer itself and how to treat it more holistically with a proper approach, the right approach. I believe there is no magic bullet in curing cancer. It cannot be. You know, no matter how much money, dollars, billions of dollars you spend, there will be no magic bullet.
My aunt was around, I think, more than 70 when the doctor diagnosed her as hepatic cancer, liver cancer. And I think from the beginning, she was taking Tibetan medicine, but that wasn't working, and she died. And I got a call from the children in the night. It was winter, and when I came to their home, I saw her lying on the bed with that thread, you know, given by that Lama, and she, you know, she was holding that thread in her left hand so tight. You know, I removed it.
He woke up, he looked at me and he said, Keval, I want to sleep on your lap for some time. So I immediately took him. He slept on my lap for around 10-15 minutes and then he woke up again. He saw my mom. He hugged her, he hugged her. And then finally he looked up, he smiled, and then he's in a whoosh, he passed away.
opened her eyes, saw everyone. And we just left, you know, all, you know, let out a happy note. But after the 10 seconds, the BP started coming down slowly. The heartbeats slowly came down. And at 7:10 on October 29th, Monday, she was officially no more.
The responsibility of the doctor also comes when the medicine alone doesn't work. So you have, doctor have nothing to offer the patient, but the patient is suffering. And then you and doctor also takes the roles of the, you know, role of the spiritual kind of teacher or the master, so that the death becomes more peaceful. His mind becomes more peaceful. Otherwise, a lot of people die with anger, hatred, kind of unfulfilled, a lot of heaviness in their heart.
So they have palliative medicines, they prepare you for the afterlife. So it's really holistic in that sense, you know, taking care, educating you about death, how to handle it.
Foreign students like Inga are no longer a rarity. Menpas are beginning to emerge from all over the world. The world has opened up, and slowly the practice of Tibetan medicine is spreading. Exchange programs like this one between Emory University in the United States and Menci Kang help both sides develop a more comprehensive insight into each other's health systems, in the hope of one day leading to an even more holistic collaboration between Western and Tibetan medicine.
So just one more thing to think about here, okay? When I bend over like this, these spinous processes move further apart. So this moves further apart, and this moves closer together.
We have so many remedies. You can compound thousands of remedies. You can find many thousands of remedies in the test. But in future, the scientists recognize natural medicine systems, then we can really contribute a lot of things to the world. If we can work very hard, if we count to work very hard, so then it will be no use.
If I go to Russia and there are so many people who need help, I will go and I will practice. If I'm not sure that I can help people, I don't think that it's good, yeah? Just to make money or something like that. So I need to be a very good student.
This is looking inside the orbit now. First of all, yellow, speed your mind. Just keep seeing.
I'll try my best to serve poor people in my own village or anywhere. My own family is from a poor background. There were many times, you know, we couldn't even afford to buy medicine for our family member. We need to understand patient. We need to know their background. Can they afford this medicine or not?
Here is the connection with Buddhism, with Medicine Buddha. Here you should think that you are like Buddha. You have that compassion and you will help people.
तो डॉक्टर कहने का ठीक हो जाएगा पर वो ठीक नहीं हुआ वो बढ़ता गया वो फिर मेरा निप्पल जो था ना अंदर हो गया. फिर मैंने सोचा ये क्या हो गया. फिर मैं डॉक्टर पास गई थी. सर्जरी करा के भी आया मैं गुरुजी के पास. कल एक लेडीस आई हुई थी, लंग्स पे चला गया, डॉक्टर साहब दवाई दे दो दवाई दे दो. मतलब इस एज में सर्जरी थोड़ा मुश्किल लगता है. हम फिर सर्जरी नहीं कराना चाहते थे. हमने कहा चलो यहाँ तिप्ती हर्बल दवाई जो है अच्छी हो गई. हमने ट्रीटमेंट शुरू कर लिया फिर, क्योंकि उससे बॉडी वीक हो जाती है बहुत. वैसे ही वीक है इसलिए.
केक बना, आज टेस्टी
बना.
बच्चे भी होते हैं, वो भी साथ अच्छा लगता
है
ना.
हाँ वो पता नहीं, अब उनके किस्मत
क्या
है. आ जाएंगे, अब पेन तो नहीं हो रहा ना.
तो नहीं होगा, आपको होता है थोड़ा
बहुत. और वो एसिडिटी बस ये है कि डॉक्टर ने बोला कि खुश रहना.
पता नहीं आंसू क्यों आ जाते हैं. पता नहीं सब
आँखों आंसू क्यों आते हैं.
दिल भर आता है.
दिल क्यों भरता है. ऐसे नहीं, डॉक्टर ने मना किया ना, ऐसे मत कर. कोई नहीं. ऐसे दिल हल्का हो जाता है फिर.
कोई नहीं, खुशी के आंसू है भगवान के मेरे. खुशी के आंसू है ये, खुशी के आंसू.
हरि ओम, हरि ओम,
हरि गोविंद बोलो, गोविंद बोलो, गोपाल बोलो, राधा रमन हरि गोविंद बोलो.
Sitting alone, the journey of life. Sizzling monsoon danced at me. Cool was the rain, fresh from above. I saw her.
I started this like an experiment because I didn't know whether this will work for me, but I was quite positive. Left with no other choice, I put full heart and soul whenever I take medicine. Not only the special pill, every time, whatever medicine I take of my God. It goes in. My job is only to swallow. Going inside, how it works, where it works, you take care.
Sitting by the window side, enjoying the grazing cows, the enchanting clouds, the drumbeats of thunder, she sang a silent song.
So living a normal life and having a quality life matters the most. No matter you live one day or you live 10 months or something like that, living the quality life is what the priority is. Okay, so basically he started walking, he started liking the food and all, and then regularly he used to come here, used to spend time with the doctors, with the staff over here and all.
He used to sit here in the seat.
This was a seat, you know, you always used to sit.
He used to sit and admire the nature. The whole nature, used to admire the nature, people walking around. He always used to see, used to enjoy everything.
Dancing to the tune of waves, singing with the voice of birds, leaving her tiny footprints, she heard a silent song.
So I feel if I had gone to them earlier, perhaps I wouldn't have gotten cancer. I just feel, I don't know. Okay, maybe they will take me along 10 years. But at least 9 out of those years, my quality of life will be good.
Reading the birds' beaks, seeing the gestures of people, enjoying the beauty of silence. She heard a silent song.
मैं अपना जाप करती हूँ, मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगता है. मेरे को कोई टेंशन मेरे दिमाग में कम हो जाती है. मुझे कॉन्फिडेंस है मैं ठीक हो जाऊँगी. कॉन्फिडेंस है. तो दवाई आपकी लंबी है, थोड़ी कोई बात नहीं. हम 2 साल खा लेंगे, 1 साल खा लेंगे. ये खानी यही है. आगे प्रभु की इच्छा है, ईश्वर की इच्छा है.
It was the song of hope, the never-ending melody of belief. the choice that she made today. The bird stopped for a moment. The people looked at her. The wind turned around. That's when I saw her.